Welcome. Welcome. Welcome, everyone. Welcome. Welcome, everyone. How are you today? I can tell this is a Friday group. All right, you've got Friday energy. Welcome to Manatee Technical Institute. I'm Mara Howell. I'm responsible for the grant writing and the public relations here at MTI. And I just want to just take this opportunity to welcome you to our beautiful, beautiful campus that was just opened in January of 2013. We're so proud of it, and we're really glad to host you here today. A couple of things, just housekeeping things. There are restrooms out both sides, both doors. You just have to walk a little ways on both sides. The water fountain is actually out this door, but you've all got bottles of water, so we should be good there. Also, the custodians are doing some work out here, and they've got some areas roped off. And so it's really important to respect those boundaries because the floors are can be wet, and we don't want anyone to fall. Because we love you all, and we want to see you all walk out of here and not be taken out on a stretcher. So also, we've got a little bank of lights that are going off and on. Please don't be disturbed by that. It's just part of the ambiance. No, I'm just kidding. We had to put in a work order for that, but they haven't been able to get out here to fix it yet, so it's just going to happen. So bear with us, and welcome. And I'm going to introduce Ted Ehrlichman now, CEO, President of Suncoast, Career Source Suncoast. I'm still not used to the new name.
All right, how are we doing on sound?
Great.
Good? All right. You may have noticed that I have somebody up here with me.
Under duress.
There may have been a little bit of duress, but just a little bit. But I did want to introduce Barb. Without making this sound like an Academy Award kind of thing, there are some things I want to do to kind of set the table for the morning. With your permission, I'll do a couple of those first. I will talk about Barb for a second. She'll introduce me and say whatever she wants about me. And then we'll very quickly wrap this up and turn it over to Simon T. Bailey. But I did want to kind of remind everybody that we're here because of the beach ball culture that we're trying to build. And before I say that, I should realize we have guests in the audience who may not even know much about who we are. I ran into somebody in the atrium out there. And realized that they didn't even understand we are a local 501c3. We're a nonprofit. We're one of 24 regions in Florida, and we are a training and employment-oriented organization. We advocate for organizations. We're an economic development partner. We advocate for job seekers, for youth, for veterans, and we're sort of a connector. So it's a partnership. I'll mention this kind of beach ball thing because Simon T. Bailey may have noticed that there is a beach ball already in the beach bucket up there. And all I'm going to say about that is that if you've been to any of the events that we've sponsored, including the annual meeting of a year ago or our retreat of just a few months ago, you heard a couple of us talk about the importance of the beach ball culture. And what that amounts to is we all live, we're born into stripes, we live in stripes, whether it's in our family or neighborhood, our work, but the importance of it is you don't have a beach ball unless the everything is inflated and all of the stripes are communicating with each other. So the whole idea here is to make sure that we're building a culture that's open, that's holistic, and has an overall, I would say, energy for improvement, and in fact a passion for it. So I do want to introduce Barb DeBoard, and I looked at Barb before we walked in and I said, "What's your title?" she told me her title, and I'm just going to tell you what I think Barb does, and then she's going to make a comment or two here. But Barb is the reason we're here, and I just wanted to. Can I be the first to just say thank you to Barb for that? I came from organizations where so much energy was developed from the team. The energy doesn't come from top down. I work for you all. Trust me, you are my bosses. along with the board, James and others, but I work for you, not the other way around. And the best thing that I could ever do, or we could do, is to clear the table so that folks like Barb can make things happen. And in this case, would you just tell us just a minute's worth, as you did for me the other day, as to how we have Simon T. Bailey standing here ready to talk to us?
Well, it was really just me at home surfing on the internet trying to figure out how am I going to do this new job that I've been so lucky to have gotten to do. And I was looking for anything that would help me to become a brilliant storyteller. So when you Google brilliant storyteller, somewhere in there Simon T. Bailey comes up. And I found a YouTube video and just was mesmerized, as I'm sure you all will be after you hear him today. So I really was just trying to figure out how to do my job well, and this is a perfect example of how to really convey a message, I think, that is meaningful. So I think we're in for a big treat today. And by the way, when he asked me my title, I said it was Queen of the Universe.
He didn't know we employed a Queen of the Universe.
I know I'm married to the Queen of the Universe. But and therefore I couldn't acknowledge two queens. And at this point I was going to ask Barb to introduce me, but thanks, tomorrow we already have that, so thank you. And we have a couple of acknowledgments that we were together going to make here. And part of the reason I've got Barb up here is that Tracy knows only too well that I am not good if left unsupervised for very long with a microphone over the task, because I need to stay on it. But a couple things I did want to say. First, thank you to the board. Could you just wave out at us if you're a board member? I think we have James Taylor, we've got David Kraft, we have Adam Kendall just arriving. So I'll tell you what, this board of directors is an amazing group of servants. They are truly servants. They have a servant heart. They understand what the nature of this kind of unusual quasi sort of government private agency is that we are, and they give us great guidance. So thank you to them. Also wanted to say thanks to Mary Helen. Mary Helen couldn't be here with us, but I'll tell you what, if you want a shining example of how to set a background, to whom I'm just eternally grateful for the opportunity, it's Mary Helen. So thank you, Mary Helen. She's recovering from an illness, and she's with us in spirit for sure. Thanks to Charles Clapsaddle, she'll be able to see this event. And I wanted to say thank you to these folks at METV too. Barbara's going to tell you about a former colleague of ours to whom we owe a gratitude.
Well, I have a couple of folks that I really want to say thank you to who've come, just stepped up to the plate, and one of them is Gail Lofgren, who used to be a CareerSource Suncoast employee. Thank you so much, Gail. She's returned to now be the president again of the Longboat Key Chamber of Commerce, and without her, Simon would be sleeping in the car, because she was the person who secured the lodging for us over on Longboat Key for him. And that general manager, Mark Mador, is here somewhere. Mark, thank you so much for being so generous to donate a place for him to stay, one of our finest accommodations on Longboat Key, so thank you.
Me? Just like we rehearsed it.
Yes.
MTI. We should talk about some more about MTI. Nancy Lawrence, Martha Myers. Who's here?
More.
Thank you so much, Maura. We so appreciate having us out here. This is an amazing facility. It is incredible.
I think most of you know about MTI, but for those of you who don't, we do career preparation. We have about 50 programs that prepare people for careers in our community and across the nation. We offer industry certifications at the national level in most of those programs. We also have adult education, teaching English, GED preparation, adult basic education. We have continuing education for people who are already in the workforce and just need to get a licensure or a certification in order to continue their job or be promoted. And we also have we are the official community training center for the American Heart Association at our East Campus. And we also have a lot of classes online. So that's a little bit about MTI.
And they do a great job. I'm in the middle of doing a kitchen remodel as if other stuff isn't enough. And I was talking to the folks doing the electrical, and I said, so how did you get to do what you're doing? So, and he told me all about stuff he'd done at SCTI and MTI and State College of Florida. And I thought, how great is that? Local guy, young guy, taking advantage of what's here. So thank you. You do a great job. I think it's time to introduce the speaker. Is that where we are? We're exactly right there. Yes, he's ready. He's ready to go. I have one comment to make on the introduction, and then Barb is going to read what she wrote as her own copy here. But my favorite part of this might be that Simon T. Bailey's mission is to inspire 10% of the world's population to act brilliantly. That's pretty cool. It also made me wonder about the 90%. It's like they had left the fender for themselves or whatever. I really don't know, but clearly they're outside, not in here, and so, you know, the glass is half full. So back in my for-profit world, I would have been saying, yes, okay, we're going to be among the 10%. But seriously, thank you so much for being here and offering your services to us. Barb is going to tell you a little more about what Simon T. has been up to.
Okay, so this is actually not my copy. This was from Simon, so sanctioned text here. Okay. As a leadership catalyst, his influence has positively impacted 1,000 organizations on 6 continents. Harrison College, a 110-year-old business school, recently asked him to create the Simon T. Bailey Emerging Leaders 6-week accredited online course. When not inspiring organizations, he enjoys his small town of Windermere, Florida. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Simon T. Bailey.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Good morning! Good morning. Do me a favor, look at the person you're sitting next to, look them in the eye, and tell them you look marvelous, simply marvelous. Somebody said I look marvelous and I feel marvelous. 27 years ago, my mom and dad loaded the family station wagon and drove me and my brother from Buffalo, New York down to Atlanta, Georgia, where they dropped me off at Morehouse College. And at the end of my freshman year at Morehouse, they called and said, we don't have the money to send you back to Morehouse, nor do we have money to bring you back home to Buffalo, but we do love you. How many realize a brother didn't quite feel the love? So I dropped out of Morehouse, moved into a drug-infested community in the southwest part of Atlanta, Georgia, only had a mattress on the floor, a bright green beanbag from the 70s, a couple of milk crates turned over with a black and white TV on top of it with a hanger hanging out of the back of the TV with a piece of aluminum foil wrapped around the hanger. How many have a visual so far, right? All right. I wasn't poor, I was po. That's 2 levels below. I was so broke, I walked past the bank and tripped the alarm. I mean, it was just... It was a bad situation. And I eventually did go back to school to get my undergrad degree and my master's degree. And my parents said, it took you 10 years to finish your degree. I said, because you didn't pay, but I love you. And what was so interesting during that time, I got a job at the Days Inn Downtown Hotel there in Atlanta, Georgia, where they left the light on for me. And went on to work for a Comfort Inn. And I was offered a job to go work at another hotel there, the Ritz-Carlton there in Atlanta. And I turned that job down because I didn't really think that I was good enough. Have you ever had moments when you think you were good enough? And part of the reason why I turned the job down is growing up in the ghetto of Buffalo, New York, living there in the ghetto of Atlanta, Georgia, I didn't quite understand the worth that I brought to any place of business. And many years later, I ran into the gentleman who had interviewed me, and he said, I can't believe you turned the job down. And I was able to articulate to him that it's not who you are that holds you back from being all that you possibly can be, or as I like to say, from being brilliant. It's who you think you're not that holds you back. And sometimes we focus on who we think we're not instead of who we are. So what happens in the brain is that literally we have brilliance, insight, potential, genius, but because we don't think we're good enough to be all that we possibly can be, we settle and we begin to listen to everything that is around us instead of really realizing that everything that we need to succeed to be brilliant is inside of us. So everybody say this with me. Say, Simon says,
I am.
Brilliant.
Brilliant.
Now we're going to try it again because I know it's early, and I want you to say, Simon says, I'm brilliant, but I want you to find your inner chutzpah. I want you to use your outdoor voice indoor on three. One, two, three. All right, turn to your neighbor and say, I'm brilliant, but I am a little concerned about you. All right? I am brilliant. That's kind of like, which one of y'all kicked me? All right, anyway. So when I talk about this whole brilliance work, what really drives me to do what I do, first of all, I am married to an amazing lady by the name of Renee. She saw me 23 years ago and just had to have me. So, she's not here, so it's my story. But Renee is my baby, my boo, the best thing that's ever happened to me. The man that you see standing before you is because of the woman who has stood beside me, sometimes in front of me, pulling me into the future. Whoever said behind every man is a woman is probably a man who doesn't have a clue. Is beside every man is a woman rolling her eyes saying, that joker wouldn't be nothing if it wasn't for me. But that's another seminar by itself. But Renee and I have been married 22 years this coming October 17th. You know, that's like 80 years in Hollywood years. And we have two amazing children. Daniel is our 15-year-old son going into the 9th grade. And Madison, my baby girl, is 12 going into the 7th grade. And no matter how hard you work, build your life around who will be crying at your funeral. It's true. Because God forbid, if you kick the bucket or check out or expire tomorrow, your job will be posted on the internal intranet and life will go on. I'm just saying. So when I talk about this whole brilliance concept, a lot of people have known me around the world to talk about brilliance. And brilliance, when I first started talking about it and started writing about it, my first book, Release Your Brilliance, which is a sequel to Shift Your Brilliance, I based that work on some of the research of Dr. Howard Gardner, who is professor of education at Harvard. Dr. Gardner, he and his team of researchers did an interesting study over a 20-plus year period, and what they discovered is that children up until the age of 4 are operating at the genius level. The same group of children were studied in their early 20s, and only 10% were still operating at the genius, or what I call the brilliance level. So now the question that you have is, what is brilliance? Brilliance is your insight, it is your potential, it is your genius. It's why you do what you do every single day. It drives you. So when you are working, no matter what you do at work, when you do what you do really well and you enjoy it, you're operating in your brilliance. So in Dr. Gardner's research, as they studied the children in their early 20s, they went back and they studied them again in their late 20s, early 30s. And what they discovered is that only 2% were still operating at the genius or brilliance level. So the question that you have, like I had, oh, brilliant one, you do know that you're sitting next to oh, brilliant one, right? Just look at your neighbor and say, good morning, oh, brilliant one. Somebody said, I'm glad you finally recognize. You may be slow, but you're worth waiting on. So the question you have, like I had, oh, brilliant one, is where did this genius or brilliance go? The genius or brilliance didn't go anywhere, but it became buried by a society that says, color within the lines, sit down, give it back, you can't do that. And the more people continue to hear what they can't do, where they can't go, and who they can't become, there's a neurological path that is created in the brain that causes individuals to shut down. So what happens is people show up at a place called work. And they have this potential, they have this genius, they want to do an amazing job. And here's what I've discovered. Let me give you a few mental bumper stickers to really kind of pull this all together. Brilliance and genius, I might operate in my it factor, that thing that I love to do, But in order for me to ignite my brilliance and take what I do at work and in life to another level, I have to be in an environment where I am celebrated, not just tolerated. And when individuals work in an environment where they're celebrated, not just tolerated, that environment invites them to be a vitamin, not just an aspirin. And when I understand how to take my potential, my insight, my genius, and do what I really love to do, there are a couple of things that I ultimately recognize. And here are two more mental post-it notes for you. I am not here to compete against you, Luke. And you're not here to compete against Judy. We are here to complete each other. So when I understand that whoever I'm sitting next to or whatever entity I represent, I'm not here competing, I'm here completing, because whatever that I need to go to the next level, you are carrying in you, and whatever you need to go to the next level, you're carrying, and we need each other. So when you bring your brilliance to a place of business, and let's just do a very quick unscientific poll, by show of hands, how many of us spend more time at work than we do at home? So if this is true, if my brilliance is to be ignited and really go to the next level, I must recognize that the person that I'm sitting next to or the person that I'm collaborating with, they are carrying the answer that I need if I engage them in dialogue and begin to pull out of them what's in them. Because the word education comes from a word called educare. Educare means to draw out. How do you draw out? You draw out by asking a question. Because the moment you ask a question, it immerses you on a quest to discover the answer that was waiting to emerge. So when I ask you a question, oh brilliant one, I'm not asking the question just to ask a question. I'm asking the question because by the mere fact that we are in an environment, there's something that I'm supposed to learn from you, and there's something that you're supposed to learn from me. Why do I say that? We realize in our economy, especially right now, our economy has begun to emerge from this economic tsunami, and globally, we are hearing that things are turning around, but what I have discovered is that in some of the circles that I travel in, there seems to be a mindset that I would call a scarcity mindset. And a scarcity mindset is, I'm gonna hold on to all the information that I know. Because if I tell you what I know, and my neck has to be on the chopping block, hello somebody. What I am advocating, oh brilliant one, that if I am really going to shift my brilliance, that means I don't have a problem teaching what I know. Because when I share what I know and you share what you know, now we come from a place of abundance and we all help each other to become better. Yes? So you're probably wondering, where did I come up with this philosophy? How did this start? So for me, a number of years ago, I joined the happiest place in the world. I can hear you already saying, it's a small world app. So it took me 2 years to get hired at Disney. 2 years, 10 interviews, and a 10-page psychological analysis. I think, Dennis, they just felt sorry for a brother. So they said, let's give him the job because he is not going away. So I get the job, and the first couple of days at Disney is spent at Disney University. And at Disney University is where you drink the Kool-Aid, you sniff the pixie dust, and you get the microchip planet right here. So if you look at me, I am all about the air condition. I'm not necessarily trying to work in anybody's theme park in Florida in the months of June, July, and August trying to work on my Godiva tan. But I do like my job. So I got a call one day to get up off my blessed assurance and go and work in the park. So I find myself at Disney MGM Studios. Today, Maria, it's called Hollywood Studios, but back then it was called MGM Studios. And I want you to imagine I've got on a blue smock, a broom, and a dustpan in my hand, and my name tag that says Simon from Buffalo, New York. By the way, go Bills, this could be the year. So, anybody from Buffalo? Anybody from Buffalo? Western New York? Woo-hoo! Hello! I love you! So, I'm sorry, this, I don't get out much, so this is like, you know, my first presentation, right? So anyway, I'm there at MGM Studios, blue smock, broom and dustpan in my hand. I'm sweating bullets. I am not loving this moment. And I was like, seriously, you've got to be kidding me. I'm just, But all of a sudden, some guests are coming towards me, because at Disney, you never call them customers, you call them guests. They're coming towards me, and I had sense enough to realize I'd like to keep my job, so I flashed the Disney smile. And they read my name tag that says Simon from Buffalo, New York. And they're like, we're from Buffalo, New York. I'm like, no way. They're like, where'd you go to school? Where'd you grow up? What's your parents' names? I didn't know these people from Adam's House Cat, but we are carrying on a major conversation. So I said to them, Maria, I said, so what have you done since you've been here? By the way, this is Maria. Everybody say hello, Maria. All right. I didn't want y'all to think I was talking to my imaginary friend, okay? So we're having this major conversation. So I said to them, what have you done since you've been here? They're like, oh, we've gone to Epcot, we've gone to Magic Kingdom, we've gone to Animal Kingdom. And I said, well, now that you're here at MGM Studios, you gotta go and ride Tower of Terror. Anybody ever been on Tower of Terror? Yeah. I mean, you literally scream your bloody guts out as the elevator drops you 13 stories. And then I said, you know, I feel like I need to probably stand over here because I'll have to smile for you to see me. Okay, anyway. Bad joke early in the morning. It was right there. It was right. Work with me, people. So I said, you got to go do Tower Terror, but I said, you got to go to Indiana Jones Stunt Spectacular. And then I said, you got to eat at the Brown Derby. And they said, really? I said, really. And so we said goodbye. And then a couple of hours later, Ted, I'm back at my desk and I have the whack upside my head. I have the V8 moment. I have the Horseshack moment. If you're sitting next to somebody who looks over 40, just ask them who is Horseshack, all right? Ask them who is Horseshack, all right? All right? I was teaching a group not too long ago, and they said, who's Horseshack? I was like, oh, Lord, age gap, age gap. So what I realized is Disney never sent me to the park to sweep the streets. They sent me to the park to connect with a family that had probably saved 3 to 5 years of their discretionary income to come to Disney for maybe once in their lifetime. And a family of four in a 7-day stay on average will spend about $10,000. So the reason it took Disney 2 years to hire me, 10 interviews, and a 10-page psychological analysis is they understood you hire for attitude, you train for success. Training does not fix what human resources doesn't catch. So what I realized, I wasn't at Disney to work a job. I was at Disney to create a moment. I submit to you that what you do every single day at Career Source Suncoast is not about working a job, it's about creating a moment. In fact, from today forward, I want you to think about everything that I do, it's all about the moment. Now, let me anchor this a little bit so this doesn't come off like psychobabble or motivational hype. Dr. Daniel Kahneman, Professor Emeritus at Princeton University, says in his research that there are 20,000 moments in a day. Everybody say 20,000 moments. Now, let's just think. Now, here's what I want you to do. For the next few moments, I don't want you to listen to me. I want you to think with me. Moments create momentum. Momentum creates monumental results. But if we reverse engineer this, how did we get to the result? It came as a result of the momentum. What's the root word for momentum? Moment. So all we really have in what we do every single day at work is we handle moments. Moments compounded over time create momentum that moves us forward or moves us back. My question for you, oh brilliant one, if you believe in the Socratic method of learning, because the answer is in the question, what did I do yesterday to create a moment?
Got ready for today.
You got ready for today, absolutely. What else did I do to create a moment? Because moments matter. whatever your job is, whatever your role is, whatever, wherever you are right now in life, what are you doing to make moments matter? Because you matter. The reason you're here in the 21st century is because the universe needs you to create a moment for everybody. I'm going to go totally Hollywood on you for a moment, for everybody that steps into your matrix. And when they step into your matrix in the moment, you become the Neo for them to help them understand the brilliance that's in them. And when they step into your matrix or your force field or your quantum field, whatever you want to call it, they're picking up on your energy that you're vibrating in the moment. How many of you have ever been around negative people? How did you know that they were negative? How did you know? You felt it. You sensed it. But let's go the opposite way. What happens when you're around happy people? Because I'm happy. I'll stop there. But anyway, right? So my question for you, what am I doing every single day to ensure that I'm showing up to create a brilliant moment? Because it's in the brilliant moment where you are infusing your energy, your spirit, your beingness into a brilliant one that comes into your space. So, if we're going to really understand this and shift, we have to start with, how do I see differently? So, let me ask you a question. How many of you, by show of hands, see the candle in this slide? Everybody see the candle? Yes? All right. How many of you, by show of hands, see the third face? How many of you see the third face? Keep your hand up. Now, if you don't see the third face and you're sitting next to somebody whose hand is up, ask, oh, brilliant one, please show me the third face. All right. Everybody's got to see the third face. All right. Make sure everybody sees the third face. Yes, yes. Everybody see it? It's all a matter of perspective. Okay? All right, now here's the point. How many of you, the moment I put the slide up and I ask you the question, if you saw the candle, you saw the candle right away, yes? But how many of you realize that the third face was always there? Here's the whole point. When I talk about shift your brilliance, it's understanding what is the third face or the opportunity that I am being invited to at this particular season in my life to see like I've never seen before. Because if I don't see the third face, I will always complain and talk about what happened yesterday or the shoulda, coulda, woulda. And I'll totally miss the moment that change is your friend, not your foe. Change is a brilliant opportunity to grow. And when I understand that, I have to begin to say to myself, if I'm going to see differently, what's the third face? Now, let me give you some modern day examples of the third face. When you look at some of the work of Apple, and when they came out with the iPhone, do you realize a phone is a phone is a phone? Yes? But the moment they put apps into the phone, it became a different conversation because when iPhone users got together, it was not about the functionality of the phone, it was about what apps do you have in the phone? Third face. So they looked at what everybody else could see, but they understood it differently. Another example, how many of you have heard of a company called Airbnb? Airbnb, okay? Couple of you, all right? I want you to pay attention and begin to read the tea leaves of the times that we're living in. Airbnb, which is a company that maybe just 1%, 2% of you have heard of, Airbnb is the new leader of what they're calling the sharing economy. What they do is, let's say you have an extra room or you have an apartment over a garage and you want to rent it out. You go on Airbnb and says, if somebody happens to be coming down the Longboat Key, have I got a deal for them? And when they come and stay at the Dewdrop Inn, you will go and receive payment from Airbnb because that person's already paid via their credit card. And guess what? Airbnb doesn't own anything, but they just created the ability for the transaction to happen because they looked at what everybody else could see, but they understood it differently. How many of you have heard of Uber? U-B-E-R, Uber, all right? Uber coming to a place near you. Uber has totally disrupted the taxi cab business in many cities. How Uber works, for those of you who are not familiar with it, it's an app that you download to your phone and you punch in that I'd like for a cab to come and pick me up. It will locate you via GPS or a satellite and you will see a picture of the driver as he or she is coming to pick you up. You can literally follow it right on your phone. That person will arrive, you tell them where you want to be taken, they will take you there, you get out of the vehicle, you don't exchange any money because your credit card is on file, it's charged automatically, and then here's the best part, they send you a survey to rate the driver in 5 stars, and you can put verbatim comments, literally in the moment. So why do I share that with you? Because here's the deal. In times of change, the shifters will inherit the earth, while the shifted will find themselves beautifully equipped to live in a world that no longer exists. So if I'm going to shift and own the moment, I have to say, in the job that I do, what's the third face? What's there? What don't I see right now? Here's what I want to do. I want to, in a moment, immerse you into an exercise where I'm going to invite you to pair up with O Brilliant One in a moment and begin to work through some questions that I've outlined for you here. And a part of me teaching this whole shift your brilliance concept is not about you just having to do more stuff, but it's really understanding how do I see the old in the new and the new in the old? How do I begin to ask myself a series of questions that will allow me to become what I teach in the book, How to Be a Shifter. Here's the bumper sticker for you as it relates to how do I not just see differently, but harness the power of Me Incorporated. When I had that moment at Disney, and I really understood that Disney was not in the theme park business, but they were in the business of creating moments, that's when Joe, I quit my job and I went to work. Shift Your Brilliance is all about how do I quit my job and go to work. I want y'all to say this to me. Say, Simon says, quit your job and go to work. Now, obviously I mean that figuratively, not literally. I know Ted was about to say, seriously, man, seriously, really? Is that it? So, when I say quit your job and go to work, here's the big net takeaway. Whenever Wall Street analyzes a stock, they issue a buy, hold, or sell. They issue a buy, hold, or sell based on how they see that stock, or more importantly, that sector or that market doing. And I believe all of us are the CEOs of Me Incorporated. And as the CEO of Me Incorporated, I am a part of a organization, a business, a brand, where I am on a team where I bring my very best and I work with people who bring their very best and together we become better. Yes?
Yes.
So when I say harness the power of Me Incorporated, I believe at times we need to do an assessment as to how am I doing? And in this assessment as to how am I doing, there are some specific questions that really, Luke, become, this is Luke, by the way, everybody say hello, Luke.
Hello, Luke.
You realize that we're both bald head and my brother from another. All right. but at times, if we're going to step into our brilliance and really shift, we have to put the mirror in front of us and begin to ask ourselves some questions as to how are we really doing. So here's some questions that I'm going to have you talk about in a moment with Oh Brilliant One. Question number one, what gives me confidence? What gives me confidence to do better today than I did yesterday? Question number two, what are my three unique talents? What are the things that I do really, really well? Third question, how do I get affirmation of my worth? Stop building your net worth and build your self-worth. Because when you build your self-worth, when you realize that you are worthy of being the best at what you can do, you don't worry about all the other things. You got to build your self-worth. Next question. I believe I add value because. How do you do that? In three words that describe my personal signature. Here's what I want you to do. I'm going to give you 5 minutes to work on this exercise, but here's how you're going to do it. I want you to work on it together. So if you're sitting next to someone, you want to pair up, work together, or if there's a threesome, form a triad and work through all these questions. You just have 5 minutes, but I want you in rapid fire to begin to work through these questions. Yes, sir. You never got the handout. Do we have some? You got an extra one right here. Thank you, Oh Brilliant One. Let's pass it on to him. Thank you. All right, so figure out who you are going to pair up with. All right. Now, here's the deal. 5 minutes. I want answers. I want to see pens moving. I want to see you talking. All right? Go. Two minutes. Thank you. 1 minute. Okay, let's come back together. If you can hear my voice, clap once. Hear my voice, clap twice. All right, so who wants to be the first to share with us one of the questions that you worked on and what you specifically wrote down? And we have a microphone that we'll bring to you so we can make sure we hear you. Who wants to be the first to share with us? Don't all speak at once. Don't shout me down. Okay, we have a person right here, right here. Tell us your name.
My name is Jerry Sutton.
Everybody say hello, Jerry. Hi, Jerry. By the way, this is not an AA meeting, all right? It's all right. Jerry.
We all had a consensus on question number 3, how do I get affirmation of my worth? Hmm. So we all agreed when people grow and we know that we've made a difference, that's how we get affirmation of our
worth. Wow. So that's great, all right. Let me introduce you to our celebratory clap on three. Clap once, 1, 2, 3. Okay, a little different. Okay, so when you talk about growth, talk to me, when I get affirmation of my growth, explain.
No, affirmation of others' growth.
Of others' growth,
right.
Okay.
My affirmation of my worth comes when I can see that I've impacted them and empowered them to grow. And all three of us believe that.
Wow, would all of you say that that would be the same for you?
Yes.
All right, awesome, that's great, thank you. Who else, another person, wanna share? Lourdes, did I see your hand? I saw your hand. I'm making it up. You didn't know I remembered your name, huh? Back here. All right. And your name is?
My name is Brian Arcuri.
Everybody say hello, Brian!
What gives me confidence? I have none.
Brian's got jokes, I see.
What gives me confidence is when I complete a task, when I do things well, when I achieve a goal. These are combination of myself and Paul here.
Okay.
When I feel that I have... when I feel I'm at ease with the task.
Ah, nice. Okay.
And there was one more. When I have a history of doing well, then that gives me confidence for the future.
Sweet. On three, clap once. 1, 2, 3. Thank you, Brian. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. All right. So here's the whole thing. The real learning of harnessing your power realizes that the learning is not in the front of the room. The learning just took place when you connected with Oh Brilliant One. Because you're exchanging and you're learning how they get their worth, what drives their confidence, to your whole point, seeing others grow. So I want you to think about this in the context of, if I'm harnessing my power, how do I create moments like this every single day for everyone that I serve and everyone that I work with? Because everything you do speaks. Everything. Every email, every phone call, every interaction, there is an exchange in that moment. And how many of you would say that there is an opportunity to improve? Yes? Okay. May I offer up 3 suggestions on how you can harness your power even now more than ever? Number one, I want you to think about, how do I become a better listener? The same letters that spell the word listen spell the word silent. And if I'm going to harness my power and own the moment, I have to recognize that if I'm talking to Joe, whatever Joe is saying to me in the moment, I so honor what you're saying, I'm not waiting for Joe to stop talking so I can jump in and get my point across. Because I haven't really listened to Joe, I was just trying to shove my opinion down her throat. So I'm really, when I'm really harnessing the power, I'm really listening, and I'm not just having sympathy, I'm having empathy. Because to have sympathy is a courtesy, but to have empathy is a compliment. So when I'm really empathizing, I have shifted from communicating to connecting. Women, you have two problems with men. I was waiting for it, only two. Somebody said, are we going there? We're going there. Hang with me, brothers. The two problems that women have with men is we don't talk and we don't listen. And when we talk about ourselves, and when we listen, we have selective hearing. But guys, I'm not gonna leave us stranded. Ladies, there's an opportunity, I believe, for you to become better listeners, because sometimes we are trying to push or force a situation when we need to step back a moment and pull. Everybody got it? Yes?
Yeah. I believe that every time you listen,
mm-hmm.
they will tell you in a way of you telling them what to do.
So Lord has just said, as we listen to them, right?
They will tell you how.
They will tell us how, because they're articulating and sharing where they are, and as we dial into that, we don't have to fix, we just help, because we understand how to provide the solution to them, okay? The second thing I want you to think about after I listen, number two, I want you to think about, how do I slow down in order to speed up? What I mean by that, the next time you're about to approach a task, and it may be a task that you are very familiar with, I want you to ask yourself a question, is there a better way? That question of, is there a better way, says that there is no limits to what I can do. There's an opportunity for me to take it to another level. Everybody raise your right hand, please. Raise your right hand. Repeat after me. Say, take it to another level. One, two, three.
Take it to another level.
All right, we're going to say it again. Say, take it to another level.
Take it to another level.
High five your neighbor. Make sure they're awake with the program. All right. So, if I'm going to take it to another level, I want to become a chief breakthrough officer, and that's number three. So after I listen, after I slow down in order to speed up, number three, I have to become a chief breakthrough officer. A chief breakthrough officer, he or she, no matter what their job is, no matter what they do in life, they're always saying, why am I doing this? And in asking themselves the why am I doing this question, they're saying, you know what? I know that I can improve. I can get better. And because it's in getting better, what you adapt is a customer love mindset. Customer service is a department. Customer love is a mindset. When I love what I do, and I love the human beings that I serve, I hug people with my words. I'm just gonna let that marinate for a moment. Love is not a word that's used in a lot of business and professional circles, but how many of you have been to places where you certainly didn't feel the love? And how many of you didn't go back? And how many of you told a few people about it? Because you didn't feel the love. And chief breakthrough officers, when you talk about building a beach ball culture, looking at all the stripes that everyone comes to work with every single day, I figure a way to love you despite of what's happening. We figure a way to get it done because love cares. Love is concern. Love releases the need to be right. Love realizes it's okay to be wrong. Love embraces failure. Because failure is not final. Failure is only feedback. And feedback is the breakfast of champions. So when I understand how to be a chief breakthrough officer and a beach ball culture, I recognize that I might be the breakthrough that the organization is waiting for. I have to realize that I have the opportunity to be the difference that makes the difference. So what is it that I can do today to break through? All right, I want you to look at this. Truett Cathy, who is the founder of Chick-fil-A, was in a meeting a number of years ago, and his executives were pounding on the table, "We gotta grow, we gotta expand. Boston Chicken Market has come on the scene, they're gonna eat our lunch." And Truett Cathy stood up and pounded on the table, and he said, "Ted, if we get better, our customers will force us to get bigger." Ladies and gentlemen, what do we need to do to get better? What is one thing that you personally can do to get better? I want you to answer that question. I want you to pair it with old Brilliant One, and I want you to say, what are you going to do to get better? Go. What are you going to do to get better? What are you going to do to get better? What are you going to do? Fifteen seconds. Okay, let's come back together. Do me a huge favor, please, ma'am, please, sir. Huge favor, please write down at the bottom of your page, the first page, whatever you just shared with old Brilliant One, what you're gonna do to get better, please write it down, please, ma'am, please, sir. If you think it, ink it. I don't wanna lose this moment, okay? Now, as you're writing it down, the second thing that I want you to realize is whoever you shared with, you're now each other's accountability partner, okay? And what this means is for over the next 6 weeks, once a week, I want you to take a moment and I want you to share and check in with each other on what you are doing to get better, okay? Anybody want to tell me right in the moment what you're going to do to get better? Anybody real quick, you can shout out. Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to be more patient.
You're going to be more patient. Spoken by Ted's assistant, and your name is? It was right there. It was right there. I love you. I really do. Why are you going to work on being more patient? All right, now I want y'all to hear what she just said. I sound like I'm from Texas, y'all. She said, sometimes when I'm interrupted, you heard her, right? I'm not as, it takes a strong person and a self-aware person to say, I know where my areas of opportunity and I'm going to get better. What she just articulated was her shift that she needs to make. Who else? Yes, sir. Your name?
Eric.
Be
impeccable with my word. If I say something, let my yes be yes and my no be no.
Eric was so amazing about what you say. One of my mentors told me a number of years ago, he said, Simon, if you say you're going to start at a certain time, start on that time. If you're going to show up at appointments, show up 5 minutes early. Because if you show up 5 minutes late, then that person starts to realize what other areas are you faulty in. All right? Yes, sir. Your name?
Matt.
Hey, Matt.
Active listening and then communication.
Why is that important to you, Matt?
To digest the instructions of what's going on around you, and then you can speak thoroughly based on your knowledge.
So I'm going to digest it, then I'm going to regurgitate what I heard, right? Thank you, Matt. Who else? Who else? Yes, ma'am. Your name?
Rachel.
Hey, Rachel.
How are you?
I'm wonderful, Rachel.
I'm going to share.
You're
going to
share. Why is that important to you? Wow.
The more they know why I do or we do, the purpose behind it,
right.
The better the connection.
Awesome. I'm going to repeat what Rachel said for those who didn't hear it over here. She said, I'm going to share more of what I do. I'm going to share the why I do it and not just assume, I'm paraphrasing, that everybody knows. So if I understand the why of what I'm doing, I'm not just existing in my silo or my bubble, keeping all of the information to myself, because in sharing, I'm not losing, I'm gaining. Here's a net takeaway. If we ended the session right now, what I would want you to do is before your head hits the pillow tonight, I want you to tell those you love, your baby, your boo, your significant other, whoever, what you learned today. Because the moment I teach it, I don't lose, I gain. Because I open myself up to acquire more information that's gonna help me shift into my brilliance. All right? What else? Who else? Who else? Yes, ma'am, your name? Hi, Bridget.
To ask questions more.
Absolutely. Why is that important to you?
The reason being is because a lot of times I give the answer and I think it puts a crutch with me just giving the answer instead of allowing the person to find the answer within the question.
Wow, brilliant. So Bridget said she's going to ask more questions instead of giving the answers. You know, it reminds me of a time when I first got promoted into leadership at Disney. I got my corporate American Express card, my name on the door. I thought I was hot stuff. But the reality is I was clueless as a boss. But I didn't want you to know that I didn't know, so I pretended like I knew. And how it was found out that I was basically an empty suit at that particular time is I went through 360-degree feedback where my peer leaders and direct reports rated me on my performance. If 5.0 was the highest, 1.0 was the lowest, the threshold for leaders at Disney at that time had to be at 4.0 or higher. I came in at 3.5, 3.0 in many of the categories and many of the questions. Such questions as, do you trust your leader? Does your leader give you feedback on your performance? Does your leader spend time with you? Does your leader understand you? And my boss called me in the office, and it was not a very pixie dusted conversation. He said, walk me through a typical day when you come in the office. And I said, well, I come in the office, read my email, return my calls, and then I'm off to a meeting. He says, you ever stop to take time to engage people in dialogue? I said, dude, I'm from Buffalo, New York. I don't care what they did this weekend. I don't care what the name of the dog, the cat, the niece, the nephew, the son, the daughter. You got the email. You got the memo. Go forth and create magic, all right? All right? Seriously. And what I had to work on in getting better is when people did come to me, I would just give them the answer. And because I was a boss with an agenda instead of a leader with a vision, I ran an adult daycare center. And the adult daycare center that I ran, I enabled people to come to me so I can give them the answers because I wanted them to do it my way. I didn't recognize their brilliance. And I think the shift in your culture and where your organization is going is that all of you have a contribution to make, and I want you to not worry about, well, are they gonna hear me? What are they gonna think? Rachel is already teed up. She's gonna share what she knows. Ladies and gentlemen, we are living in an economy right now where you gotta bring it. You gotta ask. You gotta say, what is going on and how can I be a part of the solution? So how I got better is I had to go to Disney University, the internal training arm of the company, to get re-indoctrinated with what it really meant to work in a dynamic culture of 64,000 people working within 47 square miles and there's over 2,000 job titles. How was I going to survive and really think about getting better? And you know what I walked out of the door with that's forever stayed with me? Number one, I closed down the adult daycare center. Because I realized You should not hire brilliant people to have them end up in e-jail where you're leading but not connecting. So what I had to do, my shift, how I got better, was I had to connect to find out, what do you bring to the table? What do you bring to the table? What do you bring to the table? And how do you see it? Because I don't have to have all the answers. The answers are all around us. Everybody say this to me. Say, Simon says, brilliance is all around me. Turn to your neighbor and say, I knew I was sitting next to somebody special. I knew. I knew I was sitting next to somebody special. So here's the deal. In all honesty, it took me about 18 months to shift my behavior, but I would have never shifted my behavior if I was never forced, Maria, to own the moment, to own how I was going to get better. Here's my question for you. Are you ready to get better? I believe you are. And here's what is even more important. How do we sustain getting better 30, 60, 90 days from now? Hi, thank you for calling Simon. Here's what I want y'all to do. Everybody hold up your arm where your watch is. Watch a piece of jewelry, hold it up. Hold your arm and watch a piece of jewelry. And I want you to take your watch off. Watch a piece of jewelry, and I want you to put it on the opposite wrist. Put it on the opposite wrist. Now, if you don't have a watch, a piece of jewelry, borrow something from your neighbor and tell them I'll give it to you when I see you next time, all right? You might find your stuff on eBay, all right? How does it feel having the watch or piece of jewelry? Oh, you know what? Please don't move your wedding band, because I don't want you to go home and your spouse says, is it true? What happens at Career Source stays at Career Source. You done gone to meddling now, all right. How's it feel having the watch on the opposite wrist? How does it feel? Weird, what else? Different, all right. Here's what I want you to do. What time is it? Now, it's a trick question. Most popular question at Disney is, what time is the 3 o'clock parade? That'll hit some of you later on. I know we're moving quick, all right? Here's what I've discovered. The reason sometimes people don't sustain getting better in the midst of the shift is because they have emotional equity in the way they've always done it. So when change happens, the first thing they say, why did he just ask me to put my watch on the opposite wrist? I am so not thinking about him, whatever. Here's what I want you to do, please ma'am, please sir. For the remainder of the session, and really the remainder of the day, I want you to leave the watch or piece of jewelry on the opposite wrist. I know it's gonna irk the fire out of you, and that's the point, because you've always done it this way. And the real invitation that the universe has invited you to experience is change or be changed by change. And when I really want to sustain getting better, it's not just words that I've written down on the paper, not just words that I've shared with Oh Brilliant One to impress them to really think that I'm really going to do this. I have decided within myself that if I'm going to sustain this, I got to work on me. And part of the reason why I'm taking this time to drill down, and a lot of people say, oh my God, this is like the touchy-feely stuff. It's so soft. And where's the specific ba-boom, ba-boom? Yeah, whatever. Okay, here's the deal. When you get better for yourself, you become better for business. I'll give an example. Renee said to me, few years ago, Joe, she said, you give everybody the best of you, but you give us the rest of you. Mm-hmm. Dennis, she went on to say, and I say this because your wife is sitting next to you, I want you to feel the pressure. She said, you give everybody the best, but you give us the rest. And it was just like, whoa. And what I realized is that I needed to make her a priority. I needed to make Daniel and Madison a priority. I need to be emotionally available. I couldn't just come home and sit down. I had a hard day. I don't want to talk. You're probably saying, Simon, why are you going down this path talking about home? When you become better at home, you become better in business. So where at home do we need to get better? Not just work. How do I become better at home? Because home comes to work. And when I become better at home, now some of you may say, Simon, I don't have a baby or a boo, it's just me, all right? I want you to think about what are those things that you need to do for you to get better? Not just to stay where you are, but how to shift internally. Is this okay? All right, let me pause, hold the phone. I don't want you to have death by PowerPoint. Let's just do a pulse check. If we ended the session right now, we got about 5 hours to go. Just kidding. Somebody said, you're going to be by yourself, all right? Love you, mean it. All right, if we ended the session right now, what have you learned? What have you taken away? What's resonating with you right now? Just talk to me. What's resonating with you right now?
To give my best, to be a better listener.
Be a better listener. Why is that important to you, Maria?
Sometimes I move a little too fast and don't listen to what's going on around me. I know what I know, and I just want to go for it instead of be still.
Can you say it again, Maria? I want to make sure we hear that again. Say it again, please. Please.
I need to be still. Sometimes I know what I know, and I think, oh, I can do this, and I just barrel on through instead of stopping and listening to others who have other experience around me. And so I need to be still and listen.
Good. Thank you. Who else? Who else? Yes, sir.
Share and observe knowledge.
Share and observe knowledge. Why is that important to you?
Because, like you said, knowledge is all around you.
Right. Okay. Who else? Yes, Eric?
Complete, not compete, because there is no competition. I don't have competition. I only have brothers and sisters who I want to make their life a better. So
wow.
Completing them.
Wow. So I complete you. I came from a movie. You had me at. But if you think about it, the reason you weren't born in the 18th century is because you weren't needed. Think about it. Why am I here in Florida at this age, at this time, at this place? Because you need me, and I need you. That's how I get better. Yes, sir. Matt.
Learn how to overcome the roadblocks you put up in front of you. How to adjust to them and power yourself past them.
Awesome. Awesome. Who else? Who else? What have you learned? Yes.
I think mine, what I've come away with is what I need already have.
What you need, you already have. Awesome. Yes. Yes. Yeah, if we get better, our customers will make us bigger because they will become our unofficial marketing department talking about the experience that was created for them at Career Source Sun Coast. Yes?
I think the biggest thing for me is owning my own brilliance.
Owning your own brilliance. I want everybody to hear that. So when you say owning your own brilliance, what does that mean to you?
There's that old statement that I don't diminish myself so you're comfortable. And that's really important, that it's okay that we're all brilliant.
Yeah.
It's okay to say, okay, this is my strength, this is who I am, and that's okay, I can be brilliant in that area, because if I'm weak in another, I have brothers and sisters who can prop me up, but
wow.
I want to own that I can be brilliant. I want to be comfortable with that.
You know what's so amazing about what you said, being comfortable with that and owning that? In the book, Release Your Brilliance, I talked about that most people are born brilliant, but they have their brilliance buried by everything and everyone around them. And they never recognize it and they never own it. So what happens is they go to the grave carrying with them that brilliance that was in them, and they never ignited it, never released it, and never got to a place where they could shift it because they thought this was all that life had to offer. And if anything, I have come here today to serve all of you, to just turn on a light bulb and flip the switch to say, this is your brilliant moment to be the best you. But being the best you gives those that you are connected with permission to be their best self. Because when they become their best self, we become better. And as we become better, here's what happens. Innovation happens, breakthrough happens, things that were waiting to emerge can now come forth because the culture says we're in this together and we're gonna be better because of it, because this is not an accident. Now, a couple of things, and then we'll keep going. What I have discovered in my journeys and my travels and teaching this whole work of shifting your brilliance is the reason sometimes people don't embrace the shift is because they believe that it's better to complain than to offer a solution. And I have discovered shifters upgrade their verbal software. Why do they upgrade their verbal software? Language is the software of the mind. There's almost 1 million words in the English language. The average person uses about 2,000 to 3,000 words. If we drill down even more, there are 200 to 300 words that all of us use on an ongoing basis, okay? So whenever I use words, words carry energy. So one of the things I want you to think about, if I'm going to truly get better and become that shifter, seeing differently, harness the power of me incorporated, and even thinking about, as we get ready to talk about, igniting a fresh vision, it really starts with, how do I pay attention to the words that I use? Because a culture is shaped by words. How do I think about that? How do I show up every single day? Okay? All right? Any questions for me before we go on? Any questions? Thoughts, feedback, comments. You can ask a question. Ted's in the room. It's a good time to kiss up. Come on. All right. Say what? Got a question. Oh, come on. Got a question right here. So we can hear it. Yes?
I just want to know what inspired you, because when I started reading your book, I got inspiration. So what inspired you?
You know what inspires me? I receive weekly an email, a tweet, a Facebook post, a LinkedIn message, a phone call from people from all over the world who I may never meet who read something or heard me say something and they decided, like you said, when others grow, they decided to do something. So for me, that inspires me that all I did was tee it up, but they had to hit the ball down the fairway. And that causes me to keep going. There are moments, and I have my days, where, quite honestly, I want to give up. I'm like, why am I doing this? Because, what a lot of people don't know in my story is that I was working at Disney, and I cashed in my entire 401k with significant Disney stock, took out a line of credit on the house. Daniel was 4, Madison was 18 months, and my wife said, whatever you decide to do, I'm with you. And all I needed to know was that woman who said yes to me on October 17th, 1992, was with me. So I stepped out on that, on nothing but my babe, our kids, and a hope that I would have an opportunity to share my heart and to share what I believe I'm on earth to do. And so I'm inspired every single day because I get to meet all of you for the first time. Hopefully it's not the last time, But if I never see you again, hopefully in this moment, I've hugged you with my words. I'm not necessarily saying anything you haven't heard before. I'm just saying it with my own twist. And because we all hear through filters, a lot of what I've said in the last hour and 15 minutes is hitting you at different levels because you're deciding, I need to shift because I've shifted. And I've shifted because I've decided that if today was the last day, would I give my very best today? You know why I share that? Yesterday, driving here, I got a call from a wife of one of the folks that's worked with us for 11 years. Bob is my guy, and she was crying hysterically. And I said, Shelly, what is wrong? She said, Simon, I came home from work last night, and I went into the bedroom, and Bob was cold. He was gone. Oh. And I said, well, what did the coroner say? She said, the coroner said he probably passed away earlier in the day. And she was just like, oh, my goodness. And the thing about it, when I'm talking to her driving yesterday, Bob and I had a call. I talked to her about 7 a.m. In the morning. Yesterday morning, Bob and I had a conference call scheduled at 12:30 to talk about a project that I wanted to do. And he's gone. My friend is gone. The guy that worked with me since I left Disney is gone. And so how I thought about today, I said if today was it, did I create a moment? Or did I just kind of come in, all right, I'm just going to go down here, Chris Suncoast, all right, let me just say a few words, and then I'm out. Mm-mm. So I'm inspired because all of you didn't have to show up. But you did. And because you showed up, I've showed up. And we're in this together. So whatever you're supposed to get in this moment, there's no question that is out of bounds. You ask me anything because today might be the shift that you've been waiting for. Today might be the moment. So I want you to think about it. Here's some specific steps that I want you to consider. I want you to be clear, candid, and compelling in what you want as you think about harnessing your power. And I want you to always think about the third face. Where is the third face? How do I see the third face, okay? And I just put this up here because sometimes people say, okay, Simon, great, we're talking about a lot of stuff, but what are some actionable things I need to think about? And if you kind of are following my method of instruction, I always tee up questions because so many times in the personal development, motivational field, a lot of things gets lost because the communicator is saying, you gotta do this. And I don't come from that school. I don't want to say you gotta do this because I don't know you. You know you. My job is just to ask you a question so you can decide what you need to do for you. Is that fair? Okay, all right. Now, when I talk about this whole thing of igniting a fresh vision, a lot of people often ask me, you know, why did you leave the happiest place in the world after 2 years of interviews? And the reality is, one day I was sitting at my desk and my phone rang, and on the other end of the line was a journalist from Florida Business Trend magazine. And whenever you work at Disney, Mickey Mouse rule number one is you never talk to the media unless authorized. Well, I wasn't authorized and I decided to talk to the media. So the journalist said to me, Simon, where do you see yourself 10 to 15 years from now? And I said, I see myself as the president and CEO of the Walt Disney World Resort and eventually the chairman and CEO of the Walt Disney Company. And he puts this in print, this is not digital Botox. So this article comes out, page 12, Florida Business Trend Magazine. If you have Wi-Fi in here, you can Google it. This article will come up. Page 12, February 2002. And my boss called me in the office, and he was like, dude, help me. What were you thinking when you did this interview? And I said, Larry, I work at this company whose motto is, if your heart is in your dreams, no request is too extreme, for when you wish upon a star, it makes no difference who you are. But obviously it does here. So it's funny today, but it was not funny then. One of the senior vice presidents calls me, and he's like, dude, you are about to be toast. You need me to go to the president on your behalf? I said, no, I'll be fine. And human resources showed up a couple hours later, and they said, would you please sign right here? Signed his little piece of paper and went into my personnel file. So I said, well, I guess we won't be getting the Mickey Mouse statue anytime soon. And it was probably the greatest professional mistake I'd ever made in my life. Any of y'all ever made a mistake before? Any of y'all made a mistake? You know what? Newsflash, fail faster. The reason some people don't shift is because they're afraid to fail. And they have fear, and it's the fear, false evidence appearing real, that keeps them locked in a mindset. So when this happened for me, this became, a moment for me. And Disney didn't fire me right away. I realized that, you know what, it might be time for me to bounce. So I put my resume out on the street, got four job offers, two vice presidents offers to go and work at other organizations, a senior director position to go and work for another company, and an internal move at Disney. I think one of the senior vice presidents was sorry for me, so he said, if we just bury you in the organization, they won't even know you are around. And I said no. And so this is what really inspired me, perfect segue, this is what really inspired me to leave Disney. In 1999, Disney sent me over to Paris to design a leadership program for 1,000 leaders of Barclays Bank out of London. And while I was there in Paris, I was on the stage, and Lion King had just come out. And I was on the stage, and I had a co-facilitator, Mary, I'll never forget her. Remember like it was yesterday. And I said, remember who you are. You are more than what you have become. And it just like came out of me, and then all of a sudden, I just had this epiphany. And I realized that 30 years ago, a number of people went to work and they settled for a chair, a check, and a cup of coffee in Cubicle Farm and woke up 30 years later and said, this doesn't quite work for me. But they were stuck, they were fearful. And I began to ask myself three questions that night when I went back to my hotel room in Paris. And the three questions that I asked myself that really inspired me is that, what would I do if I knew I couldn't fail? What would I do if no one paid me to do it? And what makes me come alive? That third question came out of the book I was reading at the time, written by an author named John Etheridge. And in John's book, Wild at Heart, John says, don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive. Because what the world needs are people who come alive. Mm-hmm. And when I answer those questions, I'm like, whoa. It began to shift in me to realize, it's not about having a job, it's about the opportunity to do the job better than what they hired you to do. Yeah. When people have just that little switch in their brain, they will wake up every single day and say, how do I make today better than yesterday? Who can I serve today? Who can I help today? Not because I have to, but because I want to. Yeah. So I was interviewing Joyce, and Joyce is an amazing woman, used to be an executive at Avon, and I asked her, I said, what did you do to shift? What inspired you? And she said something that was so powerful. She said, have confidence in your opinions. She said, so many times people don't say what they mean or really bring forth any ideas because they think it's going to fall on ears that don't want to hear it. Mm-hmm. So she said, you got to bring that forth, because she said, in bringing the idea forward, you're learning and other people are learning about you. Have confidence in your opinions. But the other thing she said is, beware of the imposter syndrome. The imposter syndrome is, I don't think I'm good enough, but I'm here, so I'm just going to go along to get along. I'm going to fly but below the radar screen, because I don't want to stick my hand, raise my hand, or stick my neck out because I don't know where I'm going to end up. And I am saying to you, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to get over that. And it's time to say, how can I be bold? How can I bring it every single day? And how can I really decide that I'm going to be the difference that makes the difference? So, newsflash, average is over. Average is done. Average is history. It is all about how do I become brilliant every single day. As you look under this piece of being brilliant, you'll notice something that says, be present. Everybody see that? I want you to think about the next time you interact with each other. Am I totally present or am I scattered? Wherever you are, two words, be there. Because when I'm totally present and I'm there in that moment, all of a sudden, I'm picking up, I'm learning, I'm figuring out what's going on. Let me give you an example. I lost my cell phone about 45 days ago. Actually, 60 days ago. And we're my friends from Boys and Girls Club. Boys and Girls Club. So when I was in San Francisco, I was on an unplanned digital vacation. And I was in DC and I had left my phone in the car and I had to catch a flight to San Francisco to speak at the Boys and Girls Club annual convention for 2,500 people. And I'm at the DC airport looking for a payphone. How many feel my pain, right? I find a payphone and I get a lady on the phone and I said, or a gentleman on the phone, I said, call eight my company. And I said, listen, lost my cell phone. Can you shut it down, turn it off, and send me another one? They're like, well, we don't actually handle that. We need to transfer you over to another place. But before we transfer you, would you like to take a survey? Seriously? Really? You are kidding me, right? I was not feeling the customer love. So I get the person who's the third party, and they're like, okay, no problem. We're going to have your phone overnight it to you in San Francisco. So I'm like, woohoo, can I get a woo woo? So I'm like, okay, I'm going to have my phone, not bad. Well, the next day comes, and I don't have my phone. So it becomes a ruh-roh moment. And I call them back. They said, we've got to transfer over to the third party. And I have to explain my story again to another person. And by this time, as you can imagine, I'm turning a little red. And they said, we are so sorry. We got backed up the warehouse. It became wah, wah, wah. That's not my problem. They said, okay, where do you go from San Francisco? I said, I go from San Francisco to Chicago. Can you send it to me there? I get to Chicago, no phone. Average. That's average. The next time I called, I said, put the manager on the phone because I'm kind of done. Manager gets on the phone, oh, Mr. Bailey, we are so, seriously, really? Average, mediocre. He says, okay, I'm going to take ownership of this. I said, here's what's going to happen. If you don't take ownership of this, I have 25,000 people that follow me on social media. I'm going to blog, I'm going to tweet, I'm going to post. I'm going to put the word out there that you guys are clueless and you don't know what the heck you're doing. Because this has been going on now almost 6 days and I still do not have a phone. He said, I said, what's your name, by the way? Because I'm going to put your name in the post. By the time I got back to Orlando, I had my phone. But it took almost 10 days. Now, I got a call about a month ago because I had to write up this experience. Because this particular company spends millions of dollars on advertisement, but they can't handle a person who's been married to their company for 15 years, has always paid the bill on time, and have my family enrolled. Y'all see where this is going, right? And so I wrote a blog post, how bad customer service kills good marketing. And so the manager called me, he says, one of my people follow you and they read your posts. Uh-huh. Like, really? He said, we are so sorry. This doesn't happen. Wah, wah, wah. Okay. He says, what can we do to fix it? Can we send you something? Can we send you a gift certificate? I'm like, sure, send me whatever. And he says, next time you have something, give me a call. Now, I'm going on vacation this week, right? Here's my whole point. It was average because nobody took ownership and nobody said, it's my job. And they had the audacity to ask me to do a survey. So because they were not totally present and connected, they were just trying to get a rating on a metric so that they could move on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that type of thinking, ladies and gentlemen, this economy will cause you to lose market share. So I want you to think about, not only do you matter, but everything you do counts. Everything. So the next time before you hit send on that email, I want you to say, is this email going to cause people to end up in e-jail? Because there's too much communication being done via email. Stop tapping and start yapping. Because sometimes in email, people send emails in a spirit to CYA. Instead of saying, here's what's going on, let me be present to you and fix this. It's awfully quiet here in Toothopolis right now. That's an old commercial. Everybody tracking with me? Can we reduce how much we send email? And really think about how am I inspiring? How am I helping people really think about moving to the next level? Yes? Go to page number 3, but also put your finger on page number 2. And I want to take you through one of the exercises that we put in the book, Shift Your Brilliance. And a lot of times when people read through Shift Your Brilliance, they're like, wow, you got a lot of exercises. And here's the backstory. It took me 2 years to write this book, Shift Your Brilliance, 25 rewrites and 3 title changes. And 4 different editors. So you are reading what literally I feel like, and ladies, please forgive me, I feel like I've given birth to this book. I was so glad to get it out and say, okay. But part of the things we did with the book is put exercises to engage you and helping you understand that you have brilliance in you and how do you get it out. So on page number 3, you're gonna see an exercise that it's called Mining Your Motivator. And what I'd like for you to do in a moment is I'm going to invite you to circle all of the words that's in the white spaces, not the colored spaces at the top, the white spaces, circle all the words that most resonate with you as you think about what motivates you. What drives you to be the best that you can be. After you circle as many as you want, I then want you to check off 7 of everything that you circled, and I want you to identify 3 out of the 7 of the key words or phrases that most resonate with you as it relates to, here's what motivates me, here's what drives me, here's how I want to get better, here's how I want to take it to the next level. Select 3 out of the 7. Then after you select 3 out of the 7, I want you to write the 3 down on page number 2. So on page number 2, you're going to see something that says part 2. And I want you to write the 3 down that you have selected out of the 7. Then, last instruction, I want you to select 1 out of the 3 and write that 1 down in the space provided below. All right? And this becomes the one thing. Y'all remember in the movie City Slickers? It was all about the one thing. So circle as many as you want on page 3. Then check off 7. Then identify 3 out of the 7. Write the 3 down on page number 2. And select 1 out of the 3. This is the thing that motivates you, drives you as you think about being brilliant every single day. And while you're doing this, we're gonna put on a little mood music for you. Chris is gonna put on a little mood music, all right? Go ahead and begin. once you start to finish up with the exercise and you've identified the three and the one, go ahead and share with Oh Brilliant One what you've written down and how do you make this an actionable thing that you do every single day. So share with them the three that you selected and then the one out of the three, and then how do you make this come alive, okay? So everybody should have selected your seven, your three, and the one. Okay, give you about 30 seconds to wrap that up. Looks like everybody's getting there. Who wants to share your three and the one that you selected out of the three? All right, right here, your name?
Linda.
Everybody say hello, Linda.
Hello, Linda, we love you.
Linda, what was the three and then what was the one you selected?
Inspire, listen, and empower.
Inspire, listen, and empower. Which was your one, your main?
Empower.
Empower. So why is that important to you and what does that look like in the days ahead? Okay.
Students do not have a lot of confidence within themselves, so I try to empower them to gain education.
And you do that through listening and inspiring. Okay, awesome. All right, on three, clap ones. One, two, three. All right, who else? Eric?
Tell a story. Excellence and imagine.
All right, and what was your one?
Excellence.
Excellence. And so what does that look like? Why does that drive you?
It drives me because so many people are striving for things that are byproducts. They're causes to being a person of excellence. So if I become a person of excellence and I have that in my mind, would this be something a person of excellence would be engaged in? Mm. Then all the fruit that I desire is, it just is natural byproduct. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Of a person of excellence.
Okay, awesome. On three, clap once. One, two, three. All right, Rodney? Okay, everybody say hello, Rodney.
Hi, Rodney.
Yeah, I have make a difference.
We'll get a mic too. Run, there we go.
I said make a difference, prioritize, and tell a story. My number one thing is to make a difference.
So Rodney, what does that look like to you? How does making a difference come alive and become something actionable every day that you do?
Well, one thing I want to do is take one person at a time and let them see how the future can be bright and rewarding to them, showing by example and also by other type of case studies or things that like that.
Okay, and why is this important to you, Rodney?
Because a lot of people have been told pretty much that, you know, in this environment, in this economy, they've been made to feel that they don't make a difference. They don't matter.
Mm. That's powerful. On three, clap once. One, two, three. I believe if I would be so bold to say, what you do is God's work. And the reason I say that from where I sit is anytime you can take the least, the last, and the loss, and to help them realize that they still have value, they still have worth, but even more importantly, they still matter, and that yes, they can have a job, that gives a person hope that tomorrow will be better than yesterday. And that is not a job with a paycheck, that's a calling that allows a person to become a productive citizen in society. We live in the greatest country in the world, and unfortunately at times, not everybody feels valued. Can I say that? Everybody get that? So if I come into an environment, I should be transformed because somebody took the time to care. Somebody took the time to listen, and somebody took the time to make me feel like I was important. And when you do that, I'm sorry, that's God's work. I just had to put that out there. Because we're saying in a place whose currency says, in God we trust, who in all of our Star-Spangled Banner, all the things we say, we are a country who believes in people and the dignity of humanity. Yes?
Amen.
Okay. Who else? Who else? Somebody that motivates you. Yes, ma'am. Your name?
Michelle.
Everybody say hello, Michelle.
Hi, Michelle.
Now, is that Michelle with one L or two L's?
Two L's.
Two L's. All right.
My three was inspire, truthful, and make a difference.
Okay.
My one is truthful.
All right, truthful. All right, so Michelle, talk to us a little bit. The mic's right there. Michelle, talk to us about what does truthful look like and how does it show up through you every day?
Well, you try not to sugarcoat things for once. people, if we learn to be truthful with ourselves and with others, we can improve on things. If everybody's living in a happy, glorified, candy-coated world, then nobody is going to improve. No one's going to have that inspiration to move forward in the direction that they need to go. So we need to be truthful. And truthful is not always pretty. It is sometimes ugly, but we have to recognize that.
All right, Michelle, you have opened up a can of worms. I love it. On three, clap once. One, two, three. All right, I got a question for y'all. Real time, real in the moment. Am I in a position where I can handle the truth about how I'm doing? I'm talking about you! I'm talking about me! I'm talking about you! I just want you to tell me the truth. No. But seriously. Y'all, everybody hear my heart? You know where I failed at? When I worked at Disney, and it took me a time to recover. I knew that I was a jerk of a boss, but I didn't want to take the feedback because it hurt my ego. Ken Blanchard says ego stands for edging God out. And what I really needed is the feedback that I was not all of that in a bag of chips. The moment you are able to embrace the truth, that's when you will shift and your life will go to another level. If you are not ready for the truth, you will always operate at this level when there's a whole nother dimension available. And I use the word dimension intentionally because when you study string theory, there are 8 to 10 levels in one dimension. So if I'm the quantum leap and take my performance is the price of freedom. If I'm to take it to another level, whose phone is that? Let me say hi to them. Whose phone is it? Let me say, give me the phone. Let me say hi.
Let me say hi. She got a suitcase in there. Look.
Oh,
okay.
Oh my God.
Call back.
Hello? They already hung up. All right. I was going to say, what's going on? What's going on? Okay, so here's the deal. When I'm ready to take my life to another dimension, I must be open to putting my truth on the table about how I'm really doing. And when I'm ready, and because we said earlier, we spend more time at work than we do at home, am I open to receiving feedback from my coworker who might not just have the nicest thing for me to say to me, but it's an opportunity for me to grow. And I believe if we all want to be better and sustain this, we have to say, give me the feedback. And once I got the feedback, it was my opportunity to say, either I shift or Disney was gonna invite me to find my happiness elsewhere. I'm just being straight up with y'all. That's what happened in my journey, all right? Now, here's what I want y'all to do. I want you to put your finger on the one word that you selected. So find it on page number 2. Put your finger on that one word you selected. So we already heard some people say make a difference. Some people say excellence. Some people say be truthful. All right, once you put your finger on that word, I want your finger to go all the way up to the top where you see the colored boxes at the top. The area that you are strong in and the area that you should focus on and teach are the areas at the top. So if whatever you said, let's say, who said inspire? Who was inspire? It was Leonard? All right, so inspire. We're all my inspire folks. Okay, so all my inspire folks, think about how am I communicating every single day? Because my communicating is teaching others how to communicate back to me. All right. Who had organized? Who had organized? Organize is your area at the top. All right. So organize means years ago I was working for a company. I've worked for 6 different companies over the last 28 years, 10 different jobs in 28 years, or 27 years. And one of my bosses said to me, "A cluttered desk is a cluttered mind." And he said, if your desk is always cluttered or your inbox is always full, and he was talking about the email inbox is always full because there's some emails that should have been deleted long ago, but because you don't delete them, you have to go back and keep seeing them. It drives down productivity. And so he said, you got to get organized because if it's foggy in here, it's foggy out here. Okay? So those of you who are great at organization, you got to teach that skill to old brilliant ones. Teach how you get organized. How many of you have solve? Your one word fell under solve, okay? So what you gotta think about, since that's a strength, that's an area of brilliance, how do I teach others how to become problem solvers, all right? Next area, collaborate. Collaborate is all about how do I look for ways to help build up the team, build up the department, build up my family, build up my friends, and be collaborative in how I do that, because that's your best thing that people can learn. That motivates you. And what motivates you is your core brilliance, all right? And then the last area, achieve. How many want to achieve? How many had achieved? Okay, so underachievement is thinking about this. Everything you need to succeed is inside of you. It's okay to want to succeed because what you want wants you. You would never have a desire for something unless you already had the capacity to obtain it. So wanting to achieve, I want to just help you think about this. Pursue significance, not just success. Because when I become significant, it's not just about me, but it's everybody I'm connected to. Yes? Okay. Any questions about this exercise before we move on? All right? Questions, thoughts, feedback. All right, here's my recommendation.
I would invite you to share with your supervisor, your leader, your manager, your boss, what was your one word that motivates you, that you selected? Because now this becomes something that he or she can look to you as the go-to person in this area to influence and infuse everybody else. Yes? Second thing I want you to do is I want you to teach this within the next 24 hours. You can use this exercise. Whoever is most important in your life and significant in your life, I want you to walk them through the exercise and find out what motivates them. Because when you understand what motivates them and drives them, it shifts how you communicate and connect with them. Third thing I want you to do is, if you don't have a journal, I want you to go and get a journal or buy a notebook, and I want you to start writing over the next 7 days, how do I become better in what motivates me? Because what motivates you is what's right about you. And sometimes we focus on what's wrong with us instead of what's right with us. Okay? All right? Now, let's keep going. I want to take us to a few points, and how many of you would be okay if I kind of walk you through some things in the book, Shift Your Brilliance, and kind of just kind of give you a little bit of the backstory? So if you have the book, go with me to page number 89, And on page 89, you'll see something, that first paragraph says, talks about this quote from Ron Baker called, characteristics such as passion, desire, obsession, I got my page dog-eared here, motivation, innovation, creativity, and knowledge may not show up anywhere on financial statements, but they are the traits that ultimately determine the fate of a company. This attitude does not fit well with more common command and control hierarchies, but it will become an essential mind shift in the 21st century if organizations are to reap the wealth-creating possibilities of knowledge workers. So this whole thing of, if I want to become a chief breakthrough officer, I've got to think about how am I most passionate about what I do? And passion is not about getting your way. Passion is being open to the best idea that benefits the whole, not just you. Yes? Okay? All right, now, go to the next page with me. And on the next page, I kind of give you some quick things to think about how to be a chief breakthrough officer, but I want you to look at that fourth bullet. Volunteer on a project team that is tackling an issue that impacts your department, division, or organization as a whole. One of the best things I think that people can do is to say, how do I cross-pollinate in another area to help them become better, bring that learning of how we've created that breakthrough back to where I'm at and say, here's what we did over here. Give you an example. I was working with a supermarket chain, and I told the supermarket chain, I said, if you guys want a breakthrough, you need to create a field trip and everybody go to the Apple store. Take the team to the Apple store. And they're like, why? I said, because sometimes you have to be in another environment to see what they're doing to say, how could that idea work in this environment? And it's that breakthrough thinking that causes people to shift, all right? So when I talk about taking the wheel is understanding, how do I become a cheetah and not just a hippo? A cheetah, swiftest hunter in Africa. Cheetah can reach up to 70 miles per hour in just a few strides. A cheetah has a flexible spine, an oversized liver. A cheetah has dark tear marks near its eyes, so when it's in pursuit of its prey, it's not chasing all over, it stalks its prey, and when it's within a few meters of its prey, it pounces its prey. A cheetah has wide nostrils so it can sniff and get a sense of where things are going. I was teaching this not too long ago to a group, and somebody in the back says, what happens when you put a cheetah with a hippo? They said you get a cheapo. Okay, anyway. It was right there, right? But here's the point. I have discovered, after working with 1,000 organizations on six continents in the last 11 years since leaving the Mouse House, most people come into an organization as a cheetah, but over time become a hippo. Hippo, lazy, honorary, set in its ways, this is the way we've always done it, I'm not changing, I'm getting ready to retire, whatever. Okay? But what I realize is that every hippo needs a cheetah and every cheetah needs a hippo. Because the cheetah comes in, wants to set the world on fire, change a bunch of stuff, and don't have the historical significance as to what can be done. And because the hippos have been there, done that, they can say, this too shall pass, and they need to rub off on the cheetahs so that they can say, we will get there, but the cheetahs infuse the hippos to say, well, can we get there a little bit faster? So they need each other. Everybody tracking with me so far? All right, so one of the things that I put up is, do I think like a cheetah? Because if I'm gonna take the wheel, I've gotta begin to say, am I flexible? Am I open? Am I infusing others around me? And if I'm a cheetah, do I understand the difference between being busy and being effective? I'm gonna just let that marinate just for a moment. At work, in life, am I busy or am I effective? If you're gonna shift, you gotta evaluate everything and ask yourself, is this the highest and best use of my time? Because time is the most valuable asset you have. Okay? Now, I said, what does this say? Every cheetah needs a hippo, and every hippo needs a cheetah. All right? Here's why. Hippos, they possess what?
Knowledge.
Historical what? They balance. All right? The hippos are so important to organizations now more than ever before because I believe every hippo has an inner cheetah. They just have become comfortable being comfortable. And if you're going to shift, you have to be uncomfortable being comfortable. Because where the real opportunity to grow is in the shift, right? Now, go with me to page number 92, okay? And on page 92, I'm gonna walk you through what I call fuel your mind, and this will help you think about this whole cheetah-hippo dynamic. The hippo dynamic is not in Shift Your Brilliance. It's actually a new book that I'm starting to formulate and work on. So you guys are getting my secret sauce hot off the press. Nobody else knows this yet, all right? So when I talk about fueling your mind, you'll see some things that I outline that says, see the tank is half full, choose only high-grade relationships, and expand your network. In expanding your network, I want you to think about, am I a cheetah or am I a hippo? And what network am I in? Because whatever network I am in, I am experiencing net learning. I'm learning from whoever I'm connected to, and their cheetah or hippo tendencies in the network rub off on me. So what is rubbing off on me and how am I rubbing off on them? Yes? The other interesting thing is, you'll see something that says, become a lifelong learner. How many of you are part of a book club, just out of curiosity? All right, few of you. All of you are leaders. Somebody is following you somewhere. You may say, Simon, my title doesn't have leadership in it. Somebody is following you somewhere. Leaders are readers and readers are leaders. One of the most important things you can do for yourself, if you intend to have a cheetah mindset, is to think about, how am I learning, unlearning, and relearning? How am I perhaps creating a lunch and learn at the office, or a chew and chat, whatever it is? But how are we being intentional every single day to learn? Give you a quick example. I was sharing this whole concept with a real estate company in the Seattle, Washington area. And the CEO said to me, he said, Simon, we're not a real estate company, we're a learning company. And I said, how do you do that? He says, we take a book once a month, and everybody in our leadership group reads the book. But what we've discovered is that throughout our 2,500 person organization, all the employees are reading that same book. So everybody's on the same page, singing from the same hymn, because they understand, here's how we take the best learning and apply it to our daily lives. Organizations that are going to be relevant in this economy are learning organizations. Every single day, people are saying, what did we learn last month that we've applied? Can we tweak it? Can we make it better? How do we look at things that are not working anymore and say, we're not going to do that because here's the newness of what we should be doing? And what happens is we turn work into a dynamic university where everybody, every single day, is teaching what they know. That's how you fuel your mind. But here's the other thing in fueling your mind. I want you to think about, do you have a personal board of directors made up of 3 to 5 people that challenge you to be better, to be the best you that you possibly can be? And how often do you get together with them and say, hey, here's what I'm reading. What are you reading? What are you learning? Or what are you watching? What's online? How many of you have ever watched the TED.com talks? Okay? If you have not watched TED.com, it's free, online, Google it. Those talks are from some of the most brilliant people on the planet. I'll give you another one to check out. There's a website called Lynda, L-Y-N, Lynda.com. Lynda.com is the Netflix for business. Anything that you want to learn in 5 minutes or less over time, you can go to Lynda.com. The membership is only $25 a month. And when you sign up for Lynda.com, you can watch over 2,000 plus videos of people that will challenge you to become better. Ladies and gentlemen, in this economy, if we're going to think like a cheetah and truly be a shifter, we have to fuel our mind with things that cause us to grow. Here's the other thing. What type of relationships am I in, either at work or beyond work, that is pushing me to be better than I was yesterday? Because I believe relationships is understanding I relate to the cargo in your ship. And wherever you are going on the ocean of life, I am going with you. Because whoever has your ear has your life. Whoever speaks into your ear, there is something that is causing you to rise to the occasion to be all that you possibly can be, or to stay where you are. So that's fueling your mind. Any question? Anybody read the book yet? Anybody read the book? Still reading? Any questions about fueling your mind? Any questions about fueling your mind? Yes?
I have a question in regards to the book. You had mentioned the Japanese koi, but you haven't mentioned it here.
Yeah, the Japanese koi fish.
I thought that was very interesting.
Interesting.
I was wondering where do you use it in your everyday?
Okay, so he's referencing the whole Japanese koi fish of how if it moves from a different environment, that it begins to expand and grow based on the environment. How I think you may want to consider using that is, how am I looking at the environment that I am in every single day and thinking about making a contribution to the environment that makes it better than yesterday? And in doing that, I am expanding by sharing what I'm learning, how I am growing, and that is infusing and influencing those that are around me. That's number one. The second thing to think about with the whole analogy of the Japanese koi fish is my relationships outside of work. What type of environment am I in? Because sometimes you can have a 50 by 60 way of thinking, but associate with people that have 8 by 10 thinking. So how do I be very mindful of, am I expanding or contracting in that relationship? A woman said to me not too long ago, what if you're married to him? I said, Kind of remind me of the lady that went to the doctor, and the doctor said, "Do you always wake up grumpy?" She says, "No, I just let them sleep in." But that can work the other way as well. And what I will tell you, Renee and I went through a dark time in our marriage, 1998. And I had created an environment where I had to be right. And because of my need to feel like I had to be right and to be in control, she felt that she wasn't expanding and growing and becoming all that she could be. And so we separated for about 3 weeks, and she moved back in with her parents. And what I realized is that she wasn't the problem, I was the problem. But I didn't want to own up to what I needed to do, so I was pretending to be a man but acting like a boy. And so when I had the epiphany that I was the problem, I called her father on the phone. I said, "Mr. Norman, on October 17th, 1992, you gave your little girl away to me at the altar, and I apologize for being a jerk. I apologize for being inconsiderate, disrespectful to your daughter." I said, "Can you put her on the phone?" Renee got on the phone, and I said, "I am so sorry," because I realized I had created an environment where she couldn't be her best self. I said, "Forgive me, I'm gonna get it together." She came back home, and within a few months, we were expecting Daniel. It was like, woohoo! Anyway. But my point is, we would have never gotten to that place of growth unless I had realized in the environment that I had kink in my armor, and I had to own up, and I had to shift my thinking, okay? All right? Y'all want to go to chapter 5, next chapter? Fuel your mind. Let's go to Take Your Will, which we're talking about right now. And how many of you like the U-turn story? If you haven't read the U-turn story, it's one of my favorite stories. Renee and I were going to the beach. We were going to, I think, Daytona Beach or one of the other beaches. And I drove... I drove totally in the wrong direction. I just wrong. You know why sometimes you can look at your husband and say, "You know, if you would have asked me back then, I would have told you that you missed the turn." But no, you had to be right. So I just let you go on, right? So I go and I realize, oh my goodness, I've gone in the wrong direction. So I have, you know, I got to eat turkey, and I turn around and drive back. So Luke, the next day, I'm sitting on the beach, and I'm drinking a little something with a little umbrella in it. And I said, "What happens in life when people don't make the U-turn?" And I said, "I had to U-turn, but sometimes people never make the U-turn because for whatever reason." And so when I talk about making the U-turn in the context of this, I want you to look at page 119 in the book. Page 119. Because people say, "Simon, how do I know? It's time to make the U-turn. Your zest for adventure is gone. You don't know where it went. You started a project several times, but for some reason you can't bring yourself to finish it. It's time to make a U-turn. You've been working on creating a business, and it seems as if you start and stop. You're in a dead-end relationship with no energy, no fun, no mutual respect. You always are the one giving and never receiving. Could be time for a U-turn. You're in a job that gives you no sense of purpose, no intellectual stimulation. You dread going home. You dread leaving home. Could it be time for a U-turn? You interact with an association you're now ashamed to be a part of. You're driving to work or school or where you go every day, and you're tempted to deliberately pass your exit. Could it be time for a U-turn?" And here's the thing. Let me just add a disclaimer to this. U-turn, especially when it comes to work, doesn't mean I need to quit the job and go to work. Figuratively, not literally, how do I need to show up differently and re-engage myself, all right? Your employer has laid off a lot of workers, and now you're doing the job of 5 to 7 people. Some of you right now in this room are doing the job of 3 people. Let's just be real. Can we have real talk? The U-turn is not, "Oh my goodness, they laid off all the folks. What am I going to do?" The U-turn is,
I wouldn't be in the position if I didn't have the capacity to make it happen. So I have to shift my mindset, all right, and see the opportunity in the work. Let me give you another example. How many of you have somebody that you absolutely can't stand? Okay? All right, if they're in the room, keep your hand down, all right? Just kidding, just teasing. Here's what I want y'all to do. I want you to take your hand out and I want you to turn it over to the back. Blank sheet of paper. All right, blank sheet of paper. And I want you to write down these words on the back. Do you have room? Oh, we are saving trees. We are, very good, Barbara. Can I get a little fist bump? Booyah. Okay, here's what I want you to do. All right, let me browse. All right, on this particular page number four at the bottom, page number six at the bottom, I want you to write down, see the brilliance in others. See the brilliance in others. So I just want you to write that down. And I want you to think of that person that you can't stand, that gets on your last good nerve, and I want you to write down three positive things about them. I know this is like fingernails on the chalkboard right now, but I gotta push you. I gotta make you feel uncomfortable. Write down three things that's positive, wonderful, amazing about that person. Come on, dig deep. Three. Come up with three. All right? Write it down. Think it, ink it. Write it down. Out of your mind, on paper. Write it down. Okay? And you might say, Simon, I can only come up with two. All right? We'll go with two. All right? But write it down. Everybody got it? Everybody say, I am not writing it down because they don't know who I'm talking about. Okay. All right, here's the deal. Let you on a little secret. Just because you wrote it down doesn't mean they've changed. What's changed is how you choose to see them going forward. So what I want you to do, oh brilliant one, whatever you wrote down that's positive about this person, the next time you communicate with him or her, I want you to talk to them through the lens of how you choose to see their brilliance. Now, let's apply that to work. I want you to think about, how do I choose to see the work I do? What's all the wonderful things about what I'm doing? Yes? Now, you may say, Simon, you don't know the work I do. Listen, if you are working, you are there because you matter. So writing down the positive is not going to change the work. It's going to change how you see the work. That's your brilliant U-turn. Y-O-U. U-turn. So when I choose to see it through this lens, all of a sudden, things happen. I'll give you a quick story. I was doing this with a group not too long ago, and I took them through the exercise of how do you see things differently and make the brilliant U-turn. And a guy emailed me, and he said, I realize that I need to stop complaining, and I need to become the solution to the problem. Another woman emailed me and said, I was waiting for it to happen to me instead of for me. She said, I realize I have to be a part of the solution that I want to see. That was their U-turn. Had a guy email me. He says, Simon, I manage about a department of 132 people with 11 direct reports. And one of the individuals, I just don't get her. We just do not see eye to eye. And he says, after I went through the exercise, I called her in and I said, you know what? We just don't get along. And she said, I know. I've been waiting for you. And he said, we decided from that day how we could work together to be better in our relationship because we were sending a mixed signal as to what was right, what was wrong, who was on first base, who was on second base. And he said, we have a much better working relationship now, all because we took the time to make a U-turn. Here's my question. Where do you need to make a U-turn? Where do you need to make the U-turn?
Because when you make the U-turn, you impact everybody else around you. All right? So, what's that U-turn? Here's what I want you to do. Pair up with Oh Brilliant One for the last time. And I want you to look at page number five in your handout. Page four in your handout. And I want you to pick one of the four boxes where it says your relationship with yourself, your relationship with your team, your relationship with your clients, your relationship with your organization. I want you to pick one of the four boxes, and I want you to share with Oh Brilliant One what has been your insight, but more importantly, what's your action step that you're going to take as it relates to you making your brilliant U-turn. Go ahead and begin. Okay, now the question I often get, they're like, okay, Simon, this is great. I know my U-turn, but how do I bring this down to something that I do every single day? And I want you to write this down. Please write this down. Please, ma'am, please, sir, you can write it on this particular page, number four. Write down 15-7-30-90. Now, by the way, if you play these numbers tonight, and they hit, I want you to hook a brother up, all right? Send me a little something, something. All right. Starting tomorrow morning, I realize tomorrow is Saturday, but starting tomorrow morning, I want you to get up 15 minutes early. I know. Somebody said, Linda was loving me up until then. She was like, say what? 15 minutes early. Here's why. How you start the day determines the day. I want you to chunk the 15 minutes down into 3 5-minute segments. The first 5 minutes, I want you to meditate. Just get quiet about the day. How do I want the day to unfold? What do I want to happen today? Second 5 minutes, I want you to read something or listen to something that inspires you. If you went to dictionary.com and put in the word inspire or inspiration, it means to breathe life into. And then the third 5 minutes, I want you to stretch and get aligned with the day. Rabbi Harold Kushner, who wrote the book, What Matters the Most in Life, Rabbi says, when you're operating in emotional congruence, all right, Rabbi says that everything that you think, do, say, and feel is in alignment. But when you are not in alignment, Rabbi says you are split in a million different directions and your energy is scattered. You ever had days when everybody wanted a piece of you? Yeah. Right? So he says you have to operate in emotional congruence. So 5 minutes to read something that inspires you, 5 minutes to meditate, 5 minutes to stretch and get aligned with the day. 15 minutes a day impacts 7 days a week. 7 days a week impacts 30 days. 30 days impacts 90 days. So from today going forward, Oh Brilliant One, who's decided to make a U-turn, live your life in quarters. Every 90 days, how did I get here? Now let's reverse engineer this. This quarter came as a result of what I did 30, 60, 90. How did I get there? It came as a result of what I did 7 days a week. How did I get there? 15 minutes a day. 15 minutes a day. That's how you shift your brilliance and sustain this. So this just doesn't become, I came to a little seminar, woohoo! It's not that. It's about when I talk to Ted in 90 days, how's it going? What happened in the organization? How are you guys doing? It will come because all of you collectively said, I'm gonna get up 15 minutes a day. Now, let me add a disclaimer. We're all my night owl folks, all right? 15 minutes before your head hits the pillow. Does that help, Linda? Is that better? All right? I love you, man, I love you. 15 minutes before your head hits the pillow. 5 minutes to unwind. Think about, how did I grow today? What did I learn today? Second 5 minutes to read something that inspires you before you head into the night season. And then most doctors, if not all doctors, will say don't stretch and then lay down. One lady said to me, she said, Simon, is it okay if I have a little bit of a tati? I said, whatever floats your boat, all right? Whatever works for you, okay? But that's how you do the 15 minutes, because how many of you had days when you got up a little late and now you're racing to get wherever you're going and it seemed like the rest of the day just kind of headed downhill. You been there before?
Yeah, sure.
Because how you start the day determines the day. I had a woman in my session, she says, Simon, I just had a newborn baby. I don't have a lot of time. I said, start with just 5 minutes. 5 minutes for you to get quiet. I said, you as a new mother, you owe that to yourself. I said, can you do that? She said, I can do 5 minutes. And maybe the 5 minutes, I can build up to 10 and 15. Here's the point. A little becomes a lot over a long period of time. Just start, okay? Now, here's the last thing, last couple of things. I want you, if you have not signed up for 7 Days to Brilliance, I want you to sign up for it. It's absolutely free. It's our gift to people from all over the world who read the book, who want to go a little bit deeper, who have people in their lives or their teams that they work with. We just had a company out of Atlanta. They have taken all 150 people in their company through 7 Days of Brilliance. And here's what happens. Each day you'll receive an email when you sign up for it asking you to do one thing that day to shift. And it'll take 10 minutes or less. God bless you. It'll take 10 minutes or less. And then you do that and you share it with your accountability partner, oh brilliant one, or you keep it to yourself, whatever you want to do. The next day you receive an email, you just do that action step. And then you share that with the team as a way of anchoring, here's how I intend the shift. But then the bonus comes the second week of the 7 days, we actually send you some video emails that I created with my team, and darn it. Bob was the one who came to my house and shot the videos. And I miss him, man. And so you're gonna do these videos that is Bob's work. Bob was an amazing person. And he shot these videos about how you can maintain brilliance. And he just kept asking me questions. And I was like, okay, Bob, what about this? So when you see those videos, you're gonna get the essence of what I'm talking about, really cool stuff. And then the last 7 days, you are gonna get an email from people who decided to shift their brilliance, what they did, and it becomes that personal story that really, really connects with you. So I wanna stop there because I wanna respect the time. And thank you for allowing me to hang out with you today. I hope you've learned something. And here's what we're gonna do. What time is it? 11:50. Okay, we're supposed to stop at 12 noon sharp, and we've got a couple of things to wrap up with. Did we pass out the sheet for everybody to sign? There's a sheet coming around. All right, so make sure that sheet gets around, because you guys do get educational credit for being here today, so you need to make sure you sign that sheet. Also, my friends from Boys and Girls Club just wanted to say something to y'all. Do you want to just say it here? Happy to be here, or...
Yeah.
Thank you for inviting us. This is a really great opportunity for us. Thank you very much.
And I want to say that I was in San Francisco and saw you and immediately brought some of this back and tried to employ it with our staff, but I couldn't do it justice. Thank you for the opportunity.
Awesome. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you guys for being here. So I'm gonna turn it back over to Ted and Barbara. But if you had a question that you wanted to ask me, I'm gonna be outside. We've got a table where we've got books for sale. You can buy the books or you can go online, download them. But if you had a question you want to ask me, I'll be available. But here's the one thing I do want to do. I do want to shake everybody's hand because I don't know when I'm going to see you again. And I just want to see the whites of your eyes. And the reason that's so important to me, I have to tell y'all this. The reason this is important to me is 50 years ago, this man whose lap I'm sitting on, he was an immigrant to this country from Jamaica. And I got a call last year from my mom who said, we need you to come home right away. And I walked into the hospital and they said, we only give your dad a few hours to a few days to live. And I had always wanted to hear my dad, Maria, say to me that I love you. And he had never said that he loved me. And he's in this coma-like state. And so my mom says, Reginald, Simon's here. And my dad wakes up and he says to me, Dennis, I love you, I believe in you, and whatever you do, put God first. And he closed his eyes, and a few days later, my pops was gone. At the celebration of his life, a couple weeks later, I'm standing there, Ted, and this Caucasian woman comes up to me and says, your dad was my brother. And I said, really? You know, all kind of stuff come out at a funeral. You know, you start finding out all kind of stuff. And her husband was next to her, her husband said, yeah, your dad was her brother. And she said, I could talk to your dad about anything. And when she said that to me, it was like my dad was saying through her that love has no color. Respect has no color. So like a good church service, the reason I want to shake your hands and look in your eyes, because I don't know when I'll see you again, but on behalf of my dad, who would have been married to my mom 49 years this month, the 24th, on behalf of my daddy, I just want to say I love you. I believe in you. I love you, I believe in you, and I want to hug your neck. Let you know that you matter, you're important, you're special. Go forth and shift your brilliance. Thank you so much.
Thank you. One real quick thing. Thank you.
As I'm sure that Simon T. has noticed from the fact that we have gotten a whole lot of handouts here for him, I don't have a new car or anything to present to you, but I do have a little memento, which is just a kind of reminder book of the Sarasota area from us, and scribbled in that a little bit. And I'll tell you what, you have added immeasurably to everyone here. We're just so grateful. Thank you again.